carton of eggs. These are called resurrection eggs. And if we open it up, there are 12 colorful eggs inside. Those look like Easter eggs you might have died recently, right? And inside the eggs are different objects that tell us the story of what happened in Jesus' last week of life. So not just today, but on Thursday and on Friday. Actually, it starts at last Sunday and goes Thursday and Friday and then Easter Sunday. So I need 12 volunteers, and I am going to start with new friends. Now you need to remember this. You need to remember what number egg I give you, okay? Here's egg number one, and egg number two, and egg number three, and egg number four, hold on, and egg number five, egg number six, egg number seven, I like your haircut, Lauren, egg number eight, egg number nine, egg number 10, oh my gosh, perfect, Chrissy, do you mind it, since you're a big girl? Egg number 11, and egg number 12. All right, and maybe you can help if you have someone right next to you with an egg, the two of you can open it together if you both want to do it. Okay, egg number one, what do we have, Paul? Let's look. Open it up. What do you see inside? It's a donkey. That's right. On Palm Sunday, a week ago, and give it all to me, honey, in church tradition, on Palm Sunday, Jesus rode on a donkey into Jerusalem, and people threw down their coats. Remember we talked about that last Sunday? And waved palm branches and greeted him just like a king. And everybody was his friend on that day. Everybody loved and loved him. Egg number two. Who has egg number two? Alright. Now what's inside? Three coins. Now, when Jesus got into Jerusalem, his friend, or somebody he thought was his friend, decided that he was, instead of being friends with Jesus, he was going to be friends with Jesus' enemies. And his enemies paid that man Judas 30 golden silver coins in order to tell him, in order to tell Jesus' enemies where he could be. So that represents the money that was used to pay to Judas. Egg number three. And you have a hand, that's right. Jesus went, he had dinner with his friends, and then after he had dinner with his friends, he went out into a garden to pray because he knew that he was going to be arrested and put on trial. Egg number four. I thought so. I said, these are out of order, but we'll keep telling the story. Go ahead. Egg number three. When he had dinner with his friends, he shared bread with them and he shared wine with them. And this is a little cup that reminds us of the wine that they shared. When he did that, he told them it was the last supper they were ever going to have together on earth, but they would have another supper with him in heaven. All right. Egg number five. Egg number five. Are you sure you're number five? Okay. this is like a choose your own adventure. Where the heck can go? But we'll see what we do. So when Jesus went out to pray, he finished praying and some people came to arrest him. And when they arrested him, they started to punish him and they beat him with a whip. And so that is representing the whip. Egg number six. Thank you. What do you have? Oh, these are all out of order. Okay, so they punished him, and then they said, your punishment is to die on a cross. And they nailed him onto a cross, and they put a crown of thorns on top of his head, which was kind of a mean joke, because they said, people think you're the king, but we're going to make fun of you and make your crown out of thorns and push it onto your head, and that's really going to hurt. All right, next egg. We're just going in any order now. All right, what do you see? This is the cross, and the cross is made out of nails to remind us that he was actually nailed to the cross in his hands and in his feet. Next egg. Let's keep going this way. Go ahead. When he was up on the cross, the people saw that he had a nice piece of clothing that he was wearing and said, I want that piece of clothes. And someone else said, I want that piece of clothes. And so they rolled dice to see who was going to win the piece of clothing that Jesus had. All right, next one. This is the nice piece of clothes that Jesus was wearing. a piece of cloth that had no seams in it at all. All right, next day. It's a spear. When he was on the cross, they wanted to make sure that he was really dead, and so they poked him in the side with a spear. This is a very sad story. It's difficult to hear. There should be one more, two more eggs. All right. And after Jesus died, they put him into a tomb on a day on Friday, and they put a stone over the front of the tomb. So this little rock represents that stone. It was a very heavy stone, because they wanted to make sure that no one would come and take him, and also, well, mostly that no one would come and take him. And Noah, I remember you have the last egg. Okay. And Noah, what is inside that egg?
Nothing.
It's empty. Because even though that very heavy stone was in front of the tomb on Friday, when the ladies got there on Sunday morning to go put perfume and things on his body, they went to the tomb, and what was inside?
Nothing.
Why? Tell me. Because Jesus had risen from the dead. And that is just the most amazing, mind-blowing story. It's hard to understand today, even for us. Even with our minds, it's hard for us to believe, but we know that it's true because what it tells us is that God is stronger than death. Can you say God is stronger than death?
God is stronger than death.
Seems like death is the strongest thing there is, that everything's going to die, right? We talked about this with my kids. Everything is going to die at this, but God is stronger than death. Say it again.
God is stronger than death.
That's what we're celebrating on Easter, that God is stronger than death. Well, thank you for our Choose Your Own Adventure telling of Holy Week. I loved it. Today is a third Sunday, so it's Game Sunday.
Yay!
What's that? But first there is a song. So you're going to sit in the front rows here and listen to the song, and then you can go out and play with your own ball.
This is an old song you might know, so feel free to sing along if you know it. Thank you.
this morning is Psalm 31. We'll read the beginning verses at the end. Psalm 31. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me. Since you are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. My times are in your hands. Deliver me from the hands of my enemies, from those who pursue me. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your unfailing love. And now here's the gospel as recorded by Matthew chapter 28.
The resurrection. After the Sabbath, as Sunday morning was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. Suddenly there was a violent earthquake. An angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled the stone away, and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid that they trembled and became like dead men. The angel spoke to the women. You must not be afraid, he said. I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has been raised, just as he said. Come here and see the place where he was lying. Go quickly now and tell his disciples. He has been raised from death, and now he is going to Galilee ahead of you. There you will see him. Remember what I have told you. So they left the tomb in a hurry, afraid and yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, Peace be with you. They came up to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Do not be afraid, Jesus said to them. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see him. See me. He is risen. Hallelujah.
Normally we go right into the sermon, but I thought it'd be nice to spend just a moment with the Marys in that garden with Jesus. And so Ray has said that he would sing with us this morning in the garden.
Yeah.
You can name him. Ceremony is good anyway, so whatever you guys do. That's okay. God, it is a joy. Those moments that we feel like we can just linger with you a little bit. Let this be one of those moments that we can just soak up that sweetness of being near to you. God, we ask that you would help me to think and to speak clearly, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you would interpret this message into the lives of each of us here. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
There is a ring on the microphone. A little bit. There's a Facebook page in North Reading that I absolutely love. I've come to depend on it and rely on it. It's called the North Reading Community Connection. It is a Facebook page that is made up of about 2,500 adults that live in North Reading or who are from North Reading. And it is an incredible resource. You can go to it to find out just about anything you need to know. Some people are nodding their heads, because I know some of you are on it. You say, who do I call to clean my gutters? Or why are there helicopters over Stop and Shop right now? Or what are the candidates' positions who are running for selectmen, right? You can find out anything on this page. It's moderated by two women who I know. They sort of keep an eye on it so it doesn't turn into one of those troll fests, you know, where everybody has all these negative comments. So it stays above board the whole time, and it's just a really helpful resource. So you can ask just about anything, and within minutes you're going to have a number of helpful and local boots on the ground responses. So say, let's just say, that your child absolutely loves cotton candy flavored peeps, the pink ones. Loves them. Has to have them every Easter. It's like a tradition in your house. And you've been to three stores and you cannot find cotton candy flavored peeps. So you go to Facebook and you say, okay, North Reading Community Connection, I'm looking for these peeps. Has anyone seen them? And in 10 minutes, you got 6 responses. And the first person says, yes, well, I think that I at least saw pink peeps down at Ryers, I'm pretty sure. And you're like, okay, Ryers, sure. Ryers is 4 minutes away. And so you zip in your car and you go on down to Ryers and you look and it's pink peeps, but they're not cotton candy flavor. And you think, okay, so you go back home and you get on your computer again and someone else says, I definitely saw cotton candy flavored peeps. For sure, I actually bought some for my family 3 days ago at the Market Basket in Nashville, New Hampshire. And now you're thinking, oh, like your love for your child is really being tested, right? Are you going to go a couple hours, just boat on up to Nashua, right? Just take a spin up to Nashua. I'll look down, take a ride, but I keep it like that, right? This would be your excuse.
I'm on my way.
Yeah. this may be preacher's license. So, are you on a chance? The three days ago they were peeps, but they may not be today. You're gonna go that far on a slim chance that you might be able to get them? Are you gonna do that? No, right? I'm thinking this year you're going to say to your kid, oh my gosh, darling, do you know that the Easter Bunny made you a very special kind of pea just for you? It is yellow. It is in the shape of a chick. It's just for you. Nobody else gets them. Maybe that's what you're going to do. Because to travel that far to Nashua and back on a small chance of getting something, it's too iffy. You're not going to do it. Let's think about this a different way. Same idea, different illustration. This year, I wanted to lose some weight. I have my 20th college reunion coming up in June. And it's sort of a commitment to myself, right? Like, I'm going back to the campus where I was a swimmer for all 4 years. I was in great shape. And so when I go back, I don't want to go back and be like, oh my gosh, I let myself go. This is terrible. You know, like, I want to go back and feel really good about myself. So I signed up for class at the YMCA, start working out, feeling good, getting stronger. That's great. I lost no weight. Terrible. so discouraged. After 8 weeks, no pounds lost. And everyone says nice things like, oh, I'm sure you're gaining muscle. Okay, that's nice. Right? I want to lose the weight. So I talked to my friend in the class and I said, what do you say? And she says, oh, this is what you're going to need to do. I have this nutrition app on my phone. You download the app and then every time you eat, you enter your food into there. And then you can put in your dietary macros and you can drink protein shakes and you go to the GNC store and it's awesome. And I'm like, this sounds like a cult. I don't want to get into all that. I don't want to get into all that. I don't want to do that. That's just weird to me. But then she says the key point. She says, you gotta get this app. It's free. Free. Now, this is good, right? Free is my price point. If you know me, you know this is my price point. This is okay. The nutrition, following and tracking the nutrition is kind of iffy for me, like I'm not real sure about that. But if I don't have to pay any money to get it, it doesn't cost me anything. Okay, it's worth the shot. And so here we can see that if something is iffy but it doesn't require anything of you, sure, let's go ahead. If something is chancy, if it's iffy, if it's not a sure thing, we will invest very little in it or maybe a tiny bit of something, a trip down to Ryers. We'll do that. But a huge long trip, staking our whole life on something, not unless it's a sure thing. So my question for us this morning is, was the resurrection a sure thing? Was it chancy? Was it iffy? I think it depends upon who you would have asked back then. I think if you had talked to somebody back on Palm Sunday, the first Easter egg, whatever day that was, talk to somebody on Palm Sunday and you'd said, hey, do you believe that Jesus was going to be arrested and tried, found guilty, punished, even crucified, die, and then be raised from the dead a week from now? One person would have said, I don't think so at all, because I just saw the parade that went by for that guy. People love him. Like, he is at the top of his game. He's got a lot of friends. He's not going to be arrested. That's, and much less die, resurrected. No, that doesn't make sense. Or someone else might say, well, you know, I have kind of heard like some of the authorities and stuff are not too pleased with him. He's kind of an upstart, so I can see him getting arrested, maybe punished to the point of crucifixion if they want to make an example out of him. But resurrected? That doesn't happen. Maybe a third person could have said, yeah, I can see him get arrested. I can see him get crucified. The Romans like to make examples out of people. And resurrection? I've heard some people talk and debate about whether there is a resurrection, but I myself am not really convinced. I've never seen anything like that. So that's what the people on the street might have said, but what about the disciples? Did they think it was iffy? Did they think it was chancy? The writer of the Gospel of Matthew is really clear with us, the readers, the hearers of the Gospel, that it should not have been a surprise at all to the disciples. The writer of the Gospel of Matthew actually uses the very same words, first in Jesus' mouth, to say, I will rise on the third day and meet you in Galilee. That's what Jesus tells them right before he's arrested. The exact same phrase that's going to be used by the resurrected Jesus later. So the Gospel of Matthew is telling us, yes, the disciples have been told. They have been told. They've been told. But did they believe it? Was it still kind of chancy? Let's look at the text. So we heard the text first sung by Daniel and then read by Rob this morning. We know that Mary and Mary, first thing Sunday morning, get down to the tomb. There's an earthquake. The angel comes. His robes are like lightning. The guards faint. They're terrified. And then the angel says for the women, he is not here, he has risen just as he said. He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him. And they hurry off, and then they meet the risen Jesus, who said, do not be afraid, go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, where they will see me. Same exact words. Wait a minute, Galilee? Galilee, have you looked at a map? I had to go look at the map for the sermon. Have you looked at a map? Galilee is a 3 or 4 day journey away from Jerusalem. It's like the far point of their part of the world. A lot of the disciples are from Galilee. They know where it is. They know exactly how far away it is. I imagine that Mary and Mary were like, Jesus, you know, literally, Jesus. Can you just walk with us about 20 minutes down the road and show them right now? I mean, it's so much closer. Could you just come? And Jesus is like, no, I'll meet them in Galilee. And the women are like, okay then, off we go. And they go running and they tell the disciples. How did the disciples receive this news? We don't have an account of that. Matthew doesn't tell us. But he does tell us just a paragraph or so later. That all 11 disciples, the remaining 11, went to Galilee. I'm thinking that those women were really compelling when they got there. They were like, guys, oh my gosh, you won't believe this. He's alive. And I think about half of them or more maybe said, oh wow, yeah, just as he said. That's right, he said that. Galilee. And the other half was like, that's a nice thing to think about. You're being kind of crazy right now. Maybe you're a little hysterical. Maybe you're a little hopeful. Like, come on, that doesn't happen. But the ladies, they kept at it, man. They were like, you've got to go check this out. And you know you're from there anyway. Just go visit your mother. Right? What's going wrong? Somehow those ladies get all 11 guys up to a hill in Galilee. So that's the men. That's the disciples. The male disciples. But what about the women? Was it iffy for the women? I don't think it was iffy for them at all. I want you to listen to this one more time. This was what was new to me this time when I read the text. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. They went to go look at it. In other gospel accounts, it tells us the women got the embalming spices and things and went down to anoint the body, right? Here, Matthew's saying, went to go look. Why did they need to look? Because they listened to what Jesus was saying. They wanted to see if this had happened. They went to that tomb expecting that God was going to do something awesome that morning. And that's why when there was an earthquake and when the angel came dressed in lightning, the guards fainted, the big Roman soldier men, they fainted dead away. The women didn't faint because they were waiting for that. They were expecting that something awesome was going to happen there. And then the angel says to them, not, you must not be afraid. But he says, you must not be afraid. Wow. You're not afraid. You were expecting this. He is not here. He is risen just as he said, go to Galilee. Isn't that cool? That they arrived there expecting, or at least hoping, saying, I heard it. Let's go look at the tomb. That's why when they saw it happen, they were like, yes. And they ran off and they got those men and they just lit a fire and brought them up there, gilded them up there, whatever they did. 3 or 4 days, they had to be on the road, those men and those women going to Galilee, without seeing any evidence of the resurrection, except for these crazy women. No proof. They had to say goodbye to the wife and kids. They had grabbed some money. They had to run out that door and travel and keep going. Not just to Ryers, not just to Nashville, but let's say to Austin, Texas. Okay? Had to keep going. And finally, when they got there, they meet Jesus on the hillside, and Jesus says, oh, well, it still says some of them doubted. Some of them doubted. This is hard to believe. This story is hard to believe. But then Jesus says to them, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, you now will go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Jesus gives to them what we call a great commission when they are there on that hillside. Jesus says, you put your money where your mouth is. You showed me that you have faith. Maybe that trip to Galilee was a little bit of a test from Jesus, who said, I want leaders for my church, but I need to know that you can walk 4 days with no proof except for some crazy women. I need to know that you're willing to say, yes, I believe that that's true, that God could do something like this. Yes, I believe it's true because God told me, Jesus told me this. And even though I haven't seen the evidence, I am willing to put some effort. I am willing to invest. It is not iffy for me. I am willing to go. Jesus wanted to see that in his disciples. And when they get there and show him the evidence of their faith in his work in the world, he says, now I'm going to take you to the next level. Now, instead of being followers, you all are going to be leaders. And I'm going to do great and amazing things with you. Because they were willing to say, yes, I will go. Even though I don't see it yet, God was going to take them to the next level. And so the question is, what about us? What kind of faith do we have? What kind of investment are we willing to make so that we can take a trip for a few days, even, on hope, on trust, on faith, that what God said, I love you, I have great plans for you, I'm working all things together, that what God said is true in our lives. Are we willing to go a few days, not just around the corner? Are we people who can be like the women? Like the women. And show up at the darkest place, the place where death is obviously victorious, at the tomb. Show up at the tomb and say, I think God's going to do something awesome here. Are we people who can go to our mailbox and look at the envelope that says past due and open up the envelope and say, God's going to do something awesome with this? Are we people who can get the call from the principal that they need to meet with us about our student and say, God's going to do something awesome with this? Are we people who our boss can walk by with a serious look on her face and say, I'd like to see you in my office? And we can say, God's going to do something awesome with this. Are we people who can go to the oncologist with our friend and hear what the oncologist has to say and say, God is going to do something awesome with this? Can we go to that tomb expecting something awesome? Like those women. That is the faith that I hope to have. That is the faith that I hope that you can have. And then after that, are we willing to travel? Are we willing to say, I haven't seen the proof with my own eyes yet, but I heard somebody tell me. I heard God loves me, and I believe it enough that I'm willing to invest, and I'm willing to go. I pray that we can be people who can go even to the tomb of places in our lives, a place where death and destruction and despair is almost certain, and say, God is going to do something awesome here. I pray that we can be people who are about to walk and walk and walk on faith so that we can get to that hillside with God and God can say, yes, I will now take you to the next level. I pray that we can be these kind of people. Because it is going to be awesome. Amen. All right, speaking of awesome, we have Dee and Mike joining the church today. I'm a little antsy that people are going to think that Dee and Mike are a couple. They are not. They are two people who are happily coupled with other people. So, Dee and Brad, why don't you come forward? And then Mike and Don Marie and any family, so we can see them with their family group. Please come on up. So we're going to give you a strong visual. Why don't you go ahead and go stand over there. Strong visual. There we go. So everybody gets it, right? A lot of people will be like, oh, we love your husband. So go to the electrical. Yeah. That's not how this is. All right, so... We already have a mic. Thank you. All right, I just wanted Dee to introduce herself, maybe just a couple sentences, Dee, and tell us how you came to the church.
Good morning. My name is Dee Kanak. I live with my husband Brad on North Street. And I found this church really by accident. I called to see about donating something to the Taste of North Reading back in the fall. Ended up in a great conversation with Rachel. Somehow ended up at the craft fair. And when we got to the Taste of North Reading, Rachel and Sam sat with us during dinner. They knew everyone in the room, but they sat with us. And we thought, these are some really good people, these two. And I came to the website, looked at what the church was about, and then knew that this would be the right place. And since my first visit to worship in January, I have been embraced and welcomed warmly every single week. I was able to volunteer last weekend at breakfast, and it was just wonderful. So that's how I got here.
It's great to have you. And Brad, you are in the Jewish tradition, and we're so thankful that you support the coming to the church, and we expect you to come help sometimes. We take all of you. Mike, just a couple sentences.
Hi, my name is Mike Wolfio. I am a born and raised Catholic who, well, wasn't going anymore. And then I met this wonderful woman, and she told me about this church. And I showed up for the first time, and I'm like, wow, this place is amazing. It's a lot warmer than the Catholic Church. I'm like, this is great. I think I'm going to come here from now on. And that's exactly how that went. It's nice to meet all of you.
Then the church will respond, we'll read the Apostles' Creed together, and then I will welcome you into the church. So, Dee and Mike, on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of the world, and repent of your sins? So say I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? According to the grace given you, will you remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representative in the world? And to the church, do you as Christ's body of the church reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include these people now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround them with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in the trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life.
Let us join together in professing the Christian faith contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
And now to Dee and Mike. As members of Christ's Universal Church and the United Methodist Church denomination, as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? Members of the household of God, I commend these to your loving care. Do all in your power to increase their hope, increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love.
We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
The God of all grace, who has called us into eternal glory with Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
few announcements for you this morning. There will be an Easter egg hunt starting maybe about 5 minutes after the service starts. Are there any instructions for that?
Nope. 11:45, because last year we had a visitor come just for the hunt, and so we had to rehide some eggs. So 11:45, and it goes by height, so really short people go first.
Very good. Okay, 11:45. Also, if you ordered lilies for the table, please take them after church and the hyacinths around the, or narcissus, whatever. Around the edge of the sanctuary are a gift from the church, so please take one. And then if everybody seems to have taken one and you want another one, there's still some left, please take a second one. We want them all to be gone. Please look in your bulletin for upcoming events. They're all food events. See, this is gonna go on my nutrition track. A spaghetti extravaganza, free-for-all breakfast, and mother's daughter tea are all coming up, and we invite you to all of those. There's also a special insert for the spaghetti extravaganza. That is an invitation for you to take and give someone else, because we want to invite friends to that. There's going to be a talent show component to it. My mom and I are singing a duet, which would be pretty fun. And there's going to be a lot of really good talent as well. So come on out for that. And Camille, you have an announcement.
Yes, there's sign-ups in the back of the church on the round table as you exit. Some of the things are really fun, like being in the runway crew to auction things off. Kids really enjoy that. All kinds of things you can sign up for.
All right, so lots of opportunities to help us. The round table out in our text, right? Where the sign-ups are. Thank you, Camille, for your leadership at that. All right. So that is what we have. Each week we celebrate and thank a volunteer in the church for doing something behind the scenes. And this week, Gloria Downs, who is our food pantry representative, thanked the church for supplying plastic bags and the Venture Crew Scouts for doing toiletries connect collections and for whoever it was who donated all of the Easter egg dye kits. So thank you to all those people who support the food pantry. Let's give them a hand. Talk to someone you don't know very well, and enjoy watching the kids do their Easter egg kind of thing. Please stand for the benediction. May the God who brought those women to the grave and showed them to expect something awesome be with you and remain with you until we meet again.